We are continuing a series entitled Reimagine Everything, and we've taken a number of weeks now to look at some various aspects of Ephesians chapter 3 and verse number 20, which simply says from the Apostle Paul, "Now to him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask, think," some translations add, "or imagine, according to the power that's at work within us." And we've been pointing out that there's no limitations, no restrictions on God's ability, but in order for us to experience all that he desires to do in us and for us and through us, we have to be the cooperative vessels. And so just as the scripture talks about Jesus going into one village and not doing many mighty works among them because of their unbelief that was operating in them, we can do things that interrupt or just restrict the flow of what God could do or would like to do in our lives. So we're going to try to get all those obstructions, get all those doubt and fears and anything that could stand in between us and the fullness of what God wants to accomplish in our lives out of the way. And today I want to talk to you again about this ideal of what we can do on our part to get ready for what God wants to do in his part in us and through us and for us for his kingdom's sake. And today I'm going to take you to a passage of scripture that's going to focus on an experience in the life of David. Many of you know I'm a great fan of David's story and have preached a lot of different messages from his life and from his experience. And this particular one is going to talk about the time whenever he becomes finally the king over all of Israel. You know, as a young boy, he was prophesied over by the prophet Samuel and anointed that one day he was going to be king over all of Israel. And it took a number of years. He had a number of different encounters and disruptors in his life. But finally, in 2 Samuel chapter 5, he becomes the king over all of Israel. And having become king, he immediately wants to do some things that is going to bring the nation to rally together. So on this theme of reimagining, I want you to think with David that having become king over all of Israel, he is reimagining what the future of the nation of Israel is going to look like after Saul's death and now his new leadership reign. So he does some things that are going to bring about this transformation. One of the things that he does, and I don't have time to unpack because there's so many great things that he does early on in chapter 5 and chapter 6, but in chapter 6, one of the things that he does is he points out that in Jerusalem, which is the spiritual hub, capital, if you will, of the Israelites, there is a tabernacle that's been set up. It's not the temple, the nice temple that's going to get built later on by Solomon. It is a temporary tabernacle. It happens to be the same tabernacle that Moses constructed in the wilderness. It was made out of canvas, and it was a cloth configuration as opposed to a brick and mortar configuration. But when they came to occupy the promised land, there's been no movement to build a formal structure. So on what they call Temple Mount, on the holy site, they would have the tabernacle, the canvas tent of meeting that Moses was responsible for designing in the wilderness. There's one problem that David notices with the tabernacle on Temple Mount, and that is that this tabernacle, which had two compartments called the outer court and the Holy of Holies, the inner court and the Holy of Holies should be occupied with a piece of furniture, if you will, called the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant symbolized God's presence among them. But the Ark of the Covenant is not in the Holy of Holies. They have the tabernacle, but they don't have the Ark of the Covenant. And David's thinking, if we're going to reimagine our future, if we're going to be the nation God is calling us to be, we can't do it without the presence of God. Having a structure does not make us a church. Having a building does not make us a godly nation. We need his presence. So you can build all the buildings you want to, have all the tabernacles you want to, but if there is no presence of God in the Holy of Holies, we have a problem. So David says, if I'm going to reimagine our nation the way God wants it to be, we can't not go forward without the presence of the Lord. And so we need the Ark of the Covenant, which symbolizes God's presence and a number of other things. We'll talk about that in a moment. He says we're going to have to bring it back. And we'll talk about what happened, but basically it had been lost in battle. Remember a few weeks ago when I said to you that the children of Ephraim ran in the day of battle? The day they ran, they were in conflict with the Philistines, and they were the guardians of the Ark of the Covenant at the time. And when they abandoned post in the middle of the battle, they surrendered the Ark of the Covenant to the Philistines. And so it was lost to the Philistines. Now, the Philistines had some problems with it that we won't have time to probably unpack a lot of it here today. But they basically say, we're going to give it back to you, but it never makes it back to Jerusalem. It ends up at the house of a man by the name of Abinadab, who just becomes the caretaker of the Ark of the Covenant in its interim state. So David says, we're going to go to the house of Abinadab, where the Ark of the Covenant has been resting, and we're going to bring it back to Jerusalem and get it back in its rightful place so we can be the nation that God wants us to be. We're going to reimagine our future by getting our spiritual priorities back in the right place. So that's where we're going to pick it up. 2 Samuel chapter 6. And David gathered all the choice men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Beel-Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, whose name is called by the name the Lord of hosts, who dwells between the cherubims. In other words, on the top of this ark, there were a configuration of two angels, and they believed that God dwelt in the midst of that space between these two angels. So it was actually God's presence right there between these two angels. So it's called the Lord of hosts, who dwells between the cherubims. So they set the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill, and Uzzah and Ahio, the son of Abinadab, drove the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill, accompanying the Ark of God, and Ahio went before the ark. Then David and all the house of Israel played music before the Lord on all kinds of instruments. They were basically having a parade, a celebration, of fir wood, a harp, stringed instruments, tambourines, cisterns, and on cymbals. And when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put out his hand to the Ark of God and took a hold of it because the oxen stumbled. So they're on a cart. They've got the Ark. The oxen stumble. It looks like the Ark is going to fall off of the cart. So a man with good intentions by the name of Uzzah reaches over to steady the Ark on the cart. And because he touches the Ark that's not supposed to be touched by men, he dies. Verse 7. Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him there for his error, and he died there by the Ark of God. I'm going to address this in a moment, because I know some of you are probably saying that doesn't seem right, that God would strike him dead for trying to do something to protect the Ark. I'm going to explain this to you in just a moment. But he died there by the Ark of God. And David became angry because of the Lord's outbreak against Uzzah, and he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how can the Ark of the Lord come to me? David's thinking, he was doing something good, trying to keep it from falling off the cart, and yet he dies. Now David's afraid of making another mistake. He says, how can I get it to the tabernacle where it's supposed to be if this kind of stuff is going to happen? So David, verse 10, would not move the Ark of the Lord with him into the city of David. But David took it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. The Ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months, and the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. So you get the picture. David's trying to move it back. There's a disrupting factor that happens. Again, I'll talk about it in a moment. But he needs a place for the Ark to stay until he can figure out what he's going to do. And he goes to the house of a man by the name of Obed-Edom. We know, and we'll, I think, have time to unpack this for you, but most likely he went to the house of Obed-Edom because Obed-Edom was of the lineage of the Levites, which was the tribe responsible for the tabernacle and ministering there. And he was a descendant of the Kohaths, who were specifically responsible for the Ark of the Covenant. So basically, David says, is there anybody around here who has experience or has an assignment that is of the Levites that we can entrust this Ark to until we can figure out what we're going to do? And somebody says, Obed-Edom is here. Let's take it to Obed-Edom's house. So now imagine you're Obed-Edom, and the king or one of his servants knocks on your door, explains to you what's just happened. This guy died because he touched the ark, right? But we need a place to put it for a little while. Can we bring it to your house? What did you say happened? Well, they mishandled it, and because they mishandled it, the guy died. But it's okay. We just need a... Well, I don't know. You make it sound a lot easier than what it really is. But, and we'll, again, I think we have time to unpack some of this, but Obed-Edom agrees to allow the Ark of the Covenant to be stored in his house until other arrangements can be made. The Ark of the Covenant represents the presence of Almighty God, his presence among them. Now the question is, what did he have to move, or what did he have to rearrange in his house to make room for the presence of God? The question is, what would you have to move or rearrange in your house if the Holy Ghost wanted to move in today? Father, will you bless your word and give us the anointing to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church today. In Exodus chapter 25, God is meeting with Moses in Exodus chapter 24 on the mountaintop, Mount Sinai, where he is having these glorious encounters. And as a result of this encounter, he says to Moses, the people are standing at the bottom of the mountain and they are in awe. They are amazed at the pillar of fire and the glory cloud that descends. They see it from a distance. They have an awareness of my presence, but they don't have an exposure to my presence. So here's what I want you to do, Moses. I want you to build an ark. And he gives him the dimensions and gives him the particulars of this ark, but he says to him, the reason why, Exodus chapter 25, you can find this, the reason why I want you to build the ark is because I don't want them to have an awareness of me. I want them to have exposure to me. I want them to dwell with me, and I want to dwell with them. See, here's the problem with a lot of people. They're content to have an awareness of God. They just don't know if they want to spend that much time that close to God or not. Exposure means exposure. It means everything I am, everything he is. We know everything about each other at that point. Now, as long as God's on the mountain, you know, I can do this, I can do that, and God's probably not paying much attention. But when he comes down to dwell in with me, he knows my business. He's up in my stuff now. And God says, I don't want them to have an awareness of me. I want them to have an encounter with me. I want them to have an exposure. I don't want to just be a visitation on Sunday. I want to dwell with them. And so the premise of the Ark of the Covenant was to take away the gap from awareness to exposure. To somebody that God meets with certain people on the mountaintop, to everybody has full exposure and full encounter with the Holy God. And so God was among them. So whenever they went to battle, they carried the ark because God was with them, and they would win the battles because of it. Whenever they needed to cross the Jordan River and the river was at flood tide, the priest who carried the ark would put their feet in the water, and because they were carrying the ark, the waters would roll back and they would walk across on dry ground. It was not just a box. It was God with them. God with them. And so whenever they were moving across the wilderness and they would set up the tabernacle and they would put the Ark of the Covenant in the Holy of Holies, and the people would set up their tents around the encampment, the requirement of establishing their tents was that every man's tent door had to face the tabernacle at the center of the encampment, so that the last thing they saw when they went to bed at night was the pillar of fire by night, and the first thing they saw when they walked out of their tent in the morning was a pillar of cloud by day, that God was among them, God was with them, God was for them. But through a series of events, they go to battle, they neglect their responsibilities, Ephraim mismanages its assignment, and the ark is carried off into the hands of the Philistines for a period of time. Again, don't have time to unpack all those pieces for us here today. But just simply to point out to you that it was carried away. And David says, if we're going to reimagine our future, we've got to get the ark back. We don't need a nation, David speaking, we don't need a nation that knows God from a distance. We need a nation that knows God from exposure. Can I translate that to where we are today? We don't need a God who just in which we just have on our money in God we trust. We need a nation who knows the God we trust. Not just the saying, but the actual God of whom we trust. That just doesn't drive by and say there's a church, but there is a God that meets with people who dare call upon his name. There's a difference between having an awareness and having exposure and an encounter with God. So David is reimagining everything. These two letters, these are that we have on the logo, which simply stand for reimagine everything. They have another purpose that I'm going to unpack as we go throughout this year, because it's actually two letters that begin that come at the beginning of almost 100 different words in the Bible, and those 100 words mean again or fresh or new, like repent or rebuild or repair or rejoice. 100 times in the Bible, R-E means do it again. Get it right. Refreshing it up. Let's make it right. Let's fix this. He's talking about, I believe the reason for this year for us is not just to reimagine what God could do in us, but to get back to where he wants us to be. To say, God, we want to repent. We want to repair. We want to rebuild. We want to restore. We want to renew. We want to refresh. We want to revive. Lord, do it again. So when we talk about reimagine today, we're talking about reimagining your life by making room for God in your life. You say, well, I have God in my life. No, I'm not talking about like they did. They were aware of him. I'm talking about letting him move in your house. I'm not talking about your address. I'm talking about a different house. The Bible says, know ye not that your bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost. We need to let him move in. Let him fully embrace, fully occupy. We have an awareness of him. But has he taken up full residency in us at the level that he wants to? Have we put him on restricted quarters? There's the guest room over there. That's where you're going to stay, in the guest room. Or have we given him full access? The Ark of the Covenant was designed to give God full access and full exposure. And then when it was taken and carried away, they had, if you will, a brokenness between them. The ark's still there, but they're not benefiting from that close proximity, that close relationship, that close intimate exposure. The ark was still there, but they weren't benefiting from the relationship the way God intended for them to enjoy it. So David says, coming back to Jerusalem and becoming the king over the nation of Israel, I believe God wants us to get back to the full benefits of our relationship with him. Not weekend visitation, not part-time association, but an intimate relationship with him every day. He wants to dwell in us. He wants to dwell with us, and we must dwell with him. Some of you know the Ark of the Covenant had certain elements, and it had the Ten Commandments, which was teaching them how to live right in a manner that pleases God. It had a pot of manna in it that reminded them that even though they were in the wilderness for 40 years, that God supplied their need every day. They had Aaron's rod because there was an argument over who was going to be in leadership, and they took a dead stick symbolizing each of the representatives of the 12 tribes, but Aaron's rod came back to life and budded and had almonds, and God was saying, that's my choice. You don't get to pick. I get to pick my leadership. You don't get to pick my leadership. Some believe that the five books of Moses known as the Pentateuch were not in the box but next to the box according to Deuteronomy chapter 21. And some actually believe that there was a small box built next to it that contained like a chest area that would allow the first five books of the Old Testament, the law of Moses in its detail, to be contained in there. What I'm saying to you is that this ark had significance. It had contents that would give them direction, moral and spiritual spiritual values. It would remind them of His divine providence and His divine provision in their life. See, this box had so many benefits because the box was more than a box. The box was God. God represented dwelling among them. I could preach 10 different messages on the 10 different attributes or significances of the Ark of the Covenant because it's God with them. It was the God of promise, the God of provision, the God of protection, the God of providence. All those things you see on the screen, every one of those are true because it was symbolized. Because when you have God, you don't just have one part of Him, you have all of Him. All that He is, the all-sufficient one. So when David becomes king, he begins to reimagine the nation. Not as a nation that has limited exposure, part-time exposure, a few of the benefits. He wants them to become the nation that God intended for them to be. So David, among the things he starts off with, and again, I wish I had more time to unpack them for you, but the crowning one that we're talking about today is David announced, I'm bringing the Ark of God back home. It's been lost in the battle to the Philistines. It's been stored at distance in the house of Abinadab, but it belongs in the house of God. I don't know if you can catch the illustration or the symbolism of what I'm trying to get you to grasp here today. But under Saul's leadership and many others, the nation of Israel had been content for the presence of God to dwell over there. Not in its rightful place, where it was close to them for exposure and responsibility. Everybody's making choices. How close do you want to live to God? Or how close do you want God to live to you? Because the closer you get, the more intimate the relationship becomes. The more exposure we have to each other. David says, I know there's some sides of this relationship of exposure that we probably have to address, but the benefits far outweigh the responsibilities. So he said, I want to go get the ark and I want to bring it back because we'll never be the nation we're supposed to be with the ark with an awareness of the ark. We must have exposure to the ark of God's presence. So he goes to get it. His mistake is he builds a cart, puts it on a new cart to transport it. It was a decision of convenience, not consecration. And once again, we have a dilemma. Because most people say, I want God, but I want Him on a convenient level. When it's convenient for me. How it's convenient for me. Not at the point of doing it God's way, paying the price, being fully consecrated, doing it exactly the way. See, because God's way was that they didn't get to use a cart with wheels so that the oxen bore the responsibility or the weight. They wanted the ministers to bear the weight of the ark with staves on their shoulders and be careful with their treading of the walk so they didn't stumble. They had to carry the full weight. My friend, some of you want a convenient God, but you don't want a consecrated God. You want God as long as it's convenient for you and it's not too heavy and it doesn't require too much out of you. If I can put it on a cart and crack a whip and the oxen do it for me, that's the God I want, yeah. So they chose the convenient way rather than the consecrated way. And then the oxen stumbles and the ark shifts and Uzzah puts his hand out to stop it. And because he touched it and he's not supposed to, he dies. And like David, a bunch of you are upset about it. That's not fair, God. He was trying to do you a favor. Listen to me. This is where we get in trouble with God all the time. We're judging God in the wrong verse. You're judging God in verse 6 and 7. When God says, I want you to pay attention to verse 1 through 5. The mistake was you put it on a cart. If you had done it my way, there would be no judgment of death over here. If you had done what I said, you wouldn't be paying the price over here. But you want to do it your way, and then you want to change the rules on the backside. God says, that's not how I work. Do not judge me in my righteousness unless you're going to walk in my ways the way I have commanded you to walk. God, why did you let us get pregnant out of wedlock? Is that God's fault now? Hello? I can't believe God let that happen. Really? You want to judge God in verse 6, but you don't want to take responsibility in verse 1? I can't believe God let me lose my house. Really? But you didn't want to honor him in the first fruits of all your income and all your increase? God made me let me lose my house, but you didn't honor his word. I can't believe God let my kids get into the mess they were in. Really? When he said, train up a child in the way they should go, and when they grow old, they'll not depart from it. Where were you in verse 1? I'm not trying to beat anybody down. I'm just saying we're judging God in the wrong verse. Take some responsibility over here, and you won't have as much problem over here. I might as well say it now, because you're here and you're going to get mad and leave the church anyway. David said, God, I'm not happy with you. So I am going to distance myself from you. I ain't going to church for 3 months, God. See how you like that? Going to leave your little presence right over here at Obed-Edom's house. I'll go do my own thing. And God, like, who are you hurting? God is not hurt by your decision to leave him. Obed-Edom sure isn't hurt. The Bible says he was blessed for 3 months, him and his household. So you can dodge God and dodge church and get mad and puff up and do all your stuff. The only person you're going to hurt is you. Because God is going to keep moving, and the people who will spend time with him are going to keep getting blessed. Think if I had a meter, about half the television broadcast just shut down right there. And since they did, I'll go ahead and say it, because they're watching by convenience rather than by consecration. We conveniently watch God on our time, when we want to, how we want to, blah, blah, blah. What about bringing the sacrifice of praise? What about honoring him? Take more risk going to Walmart than you do coming to church. Let me talk about Obed-Edom. I'll get you out of here. The reason why they went to Obed-Edom's house is because he was a member of the Levite tribe. He was a part of the Kohath family who was responsible for the caretakers of the ark. If anybody knew the significance and the responsibility of the ark, Obed-Edom understood it. And when they knocked on his door, don't you know, his heart was gripped when he thought, this used to be my job. I used to be in the presence of the ark every day. And somehow I have allowed myself to become content in my house while the presence of God is somewhere else. I think his heart was smitten. I feel like he was gripped with the reality, the weight of this moment. And without hesitation, I believe he opened up his house to let the Ark of the Covenant come in. What would you have to change? How would your house or your life be effective if the Holy Ghost knocked on your door right now and said, I'm not asking for visitation today, I'm asking for habitation today. I don't want a 90-minute Sunday morning service with you. I want a 24/7, 7 days a week, 365. I want a every day when you wake up and fall asleep. You hear what I'm saying? I don't want a turn me off, turn me on kind of relationship. I want to be there as a constant in your influence in your life. Would you accommodate? Let me say it this way. Do you accommodate God's presence in your personal life the same way you do when you come to church? Oh, when you come to church, you get your praise on. Oh, yeah. Do you praise him when you're not in church? Oh, you got your Bible open now. Do you know what it is to open it up when you're not in church? You're treating God different in here than you do out there? That's what we're asking. See, Obed-Edom's house is going to get blessed because of what he's about to do. But let me tell you, and let's be clear about this, being blessed is a matter of choice, not a matter of chance. He said to David, meditate in my word day and night, and then you shall have good success. Obey all these things that I command you this day, and all these blessings will come upon you and overtake you. You'll be blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed, whatever your hands do is going to prosper. It is not by chance that we're blessed. It's by choice that we're blessed. When we do the right things, the blessings of the Lord follow us. I got to hurry, and I'm going to give them to you fast, so hang on. Because I think there are five things Obed-Edom had to do to make room for the Ark of the Covenant in his house. Number one, he had to repent of some things. I think he had to smite himself and say, how is it that I've come to the place that I was content to live with an awareness of his presence and not with an exposure to his presence? He knew where the ark was. Everybody knew it was Abinadab's house. But he made no efforts to go to Abinadab's house and say, can I just sit here in the presence of the ark? He never made that trek. And when the ark comes to his house, he's got to think, oh, I should have visited. I should have gone there. But he's come here. You know why? Because as long as the ark was somewhere else, he was relieved of his responsibilities. He had more personal time. More time for me. Yeah, and we all know it's all about me, right? We're in the it's all about me generation. So when, as long as the ark's over there and it's not here, it's about me. But when God moves in, it's about him. There has to be less of me and more of him when God moves in. How do you know when he's moved in? How do you know when he's really dwelling inside of you? Because there's more of him and less of you. As long as there's more of you than there is of him, he haven't given him full occupation. You've given him a guest room, but you haven't given him full occupation. I think he had to repent of some things, just like I think maybe if we're going to reimagine what God wants to do in us, maybe we're going to have to repent of some things. Maybe we haven't been reading our Bibles like we should. Maybe we haven't been praying the way we should. Maybe we haven't been giving God as much attention as we should because we've been giving it to us. I think not only did he have to repent, I think he had to remove some stuff. I remember, you know, pulling up in somebody's yard and ringing the doorbell and the scuffling in the house. Put that stuff away. The preacher's here. Too late. God was inside before I was. If you knew God was coming to your house an hour from now, what would you run home and remove? Mm-hmm. May not be habits and addictions and things of that nature. Maybe you need to get rid of some attitudes, some unforgiveness, some bitterness, some jealousy, some lust. I think when he heard that knock on the door and they said, can we move the ark in here? He's thinking to himself, there's not room in this house for the ark and all my stuff. I'm going to have to get rid of some stuff. After all, some stuff doesn't need to be in the same house with the Ark of the Covenant. Remember what happened when they took the Ark of the Covenant and they put it in the Philistine temple with Dagon? All those gods fell over and broke their necks. Some of the stuff in your house doesn't need to cohabitate with God. It needs to be removed so God can move in. I think some things have to be repented of. Some things he had to remove. Some things he had to rearrange. You know, we arrange our homes based on our preferences. We got our easy chairs and our dining room tables. We got stuff. But when you move in the ark, you just can't give it the leftover corner. You just can't give it the closet or the attic space. The ark is sacred. It's symbolic of his divine presence. And so I think when Obed-Edom saw the ark coming in, he's like, I just can't put it anywhere. I got to put it in a place of prominence. I got to put it in a place of real importance. So let me move all this stuff that I thought was important and let me put it right here as the centerpiece. See, I'm not going to tuck it in a corner where people have to kind of, well, that's over there. I'm going to put it in the central passageway, that whether I'm going to the kitchen or to the front door, whether I'm going to the bedroom or the back door, wherever I'm going, I got to pass by his presence on the way. Rearrange. You got to reprioritize. You might have to move the kitchen table. You might have to move the easy chair. You might have to move. You hear what I'm talking about symbolically, right? You may have to rearrange some things in your life to give God the place of preeminence and prominence that he rightfully deserves. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. First, does he have the best spot in your house? Does he have the best spot? You got to repent some things. You got to remove some things. You got to rearrange some things. You probably have to rebuild some things. In most cases, the Ark of the Covenant did not sit directly on the ground. It was considered sacred. So they had some kind of a pedestal, and some people might call it an altar, that had to be built to allow that Ark of the Covenant to have a place of elevation, of prominence, of respect and honor. I wonder if you're going to have to rebuild the altar in your house again. The altar of prayer, the altar of repentance, the altar of consecration, the altar of dedication. The place where we fall down and make ourselves broken before God and say, not my will, thy will be done. Because if God's going to be in a place of prominence in your life, he has to be above your will, not below your will. And the altar is where we give up our will and say, not my will, thy will be done. I think he had to repent of some things, remove some things, rearrange some things, rebuild some things. But here's what I also know. Because of his legacy, because of his heritage, he had to re-anoint some things. Every time they moved the tabernacle in the Old Testament and set it back up, the Levites had to go through and re-anoint every piece of furniture in the tabernacle so that it would be sanctified and set apart for a holy purpose. And I'm suggesting to you this morning that I think it's time for a new anointing. I think it's time we say, God, I'm going to come before you again. I have been making these shifts in my life, and I'm here to repent today. I'm here to remove some things today. I'm here today to rearrange some things and to rebuild some things. But God, I need a fresh anointing. I need my life to be consecrated and dedicated and anointed for this season and for this hour, because nothing works without the anointing upon our lives. And if you want to reimagine your future, if you want to reimagine your life, if you want to reimagine your family, your business, and your future, you need to repent, you need to remove, you need to rearrange, you need to rebuild, and you need to ask God to reanoint you with fresh oil upon your life again. The testimony of Obed-Edom. David got the message. The ark has been there for 3 months, and Obed-Edom and all his household has been blessed. When you reimagine your life, it's necessarily going to be your life that gets right. Your sons and your daughters, your nieces and your nephews, your brothers and your sisters, your mamas and your daddies, your household. Everyone connected to you is going to feel the result of your life getting back where it needs to be spiritually. Friends, we need God to reawaken us. We need not an awareness. We need a fresh exposure to the anointing of Almighty God. Would you stand with me this morning and give him some praise in this house here today? This is a simple invitation. You heard the word here today. I'm not suggesting you're backslid. I think there's seasons in our life where Obed-Edom was still loving God. He was just loving God at a distant relationship. It wasn't as fresh and as vibrant as it needed to be. But something's speaking to you today. It might be one, might be all five of those points. Maybe there's something you need to repent of. Maybe there's something you need to remove. Maybe there's some things you need to rearrange and reprioritize in your life. Maybe there's something you need to rebuild, like an altar of prayer and commitment. And maybe you just need to ask God to give you fresh anointing. While they sing this song, I just invite you to come. You can kneel, you can stand, you can lift your hands, you can get on your knees, I don't care. But if you want to respond to that message, however it ministers to you, however it affects you, while they sing this song, I want you to come. This is it. This is the invitation. I just want you to come. Go ahead, Pastor Henry.